Welcome to the Educational Duct Tape Podcast with
Tony Vincent.
Hi, welcome to the Educational Duct Tape Podcast. I'm your host, Tony Vincent, and my guest is Jake Miller. He's written a new book called Educational Duct Tape. In case you're not familiar with him, let me read his About the Author page from his book. Jake Miller is an 8th grade science teacher, EdTech and learning enthusiast, and host of the Educational Duct Tape Podcast. That sounds familiar. Jake previously spent 5 years as a technology integration specialist and an additional 12 years in the classroom teaching math, science, and STEM at various grade levels. Jake's favorite job, however, is his full-time position as husband and father. Jake, welcome to the podcast. Thanks for joining me.
Thank you for having me, Tony. This is one of my favorite podcasts. I listen every week, and it's an honor to get to be on it as a guest. Thank you. You're doing such great work here on this podcast, Tony.
Thank you.
So I guess I should introduce Tony here since he's turned the tables on me and is interviewing me here in today's episode. You guys are probably already familiar with Tony from his previous appearance on the Educational Duct Tape Podcast and his rock star work online at learninginhand.com and on Twitter and on Instagram and on all the places and at your local conferences and your virtual conferences and all of those places. But Tony has been a fifth grade teacher and a tech coach. From his home in Iowa, Tony shares friendly ways for teachers to reach, empower, and inspire their students. And Tony has been spending this summer reaching, empowering, and inspiring my own children because my kids have been doing Shapegrams this summer, Tony, and they are in love with it. They are having so much fun with Shapegrams.
That is awesome.
Do you know what their favorite part is, Tony?
I was going to ask. It's got to be the jokes, right?
It is not the cheesy jokes. Every time there's a cheesy joke, they're like,
ugh. that's the reaction I go for.
Like, this guy's a sense of humor like you, Dad. But yeah, so there's three Miller children, and the two youngest in particular, Beckett, my 7-year-old, and Parker, my 10-year-old, have really taken to Shapegrams. We were enjoying the one the other day where they do their own I forget what you call it, but kind of like their profile picture, the Shapegram version of themselves. My favorite is when they do it. Parker, my 10-year-old daughter, is very, I don't know if she's like literal or like she works really hard to do things really well. And so she wants hers to match yours. Like she goes for exactly what Tony does in the Shapegrams videos. And my son, Beckett, who we call the exclamation point on the Miller family, he's our goofball. He's the character of the household. And he is like, mine's going to have a purple roof and mine's going to have a green door. And I'm going to add this ridiculous thing over here. And I know this chimney is supposed to be this tall, but I'm going to make it 20 feet tall. I'm like, hey, you're developing your skills in Google Drawings and Google Slides and some spatial reasoning. I'm good with it, even if yours ends up looking goofy, but he has such a blast with it.
That's so fun. I'm glad they're learning with them. And I guess for people listening that don't know what they are.
This is host of the show has got to make sure.
Yes, I got to do my hosting duties here and make sure the audience is still with us.
Right.
Shapegrams are a series of drawing challenges. And each one is packaged inside of Google Drawings, and it has a picture to recreate, some space to draw it. There's also an instructional video hosted by me, some drawing tips, and then there's a side activity on there too. So it's designed where parents, teachers can just give a kid the link, the make a copy link. Yep. They make a copy, and then inside the document, they have everything to create what I've created and then some, and then put their own spin on these pictures. So like the first one's a house, then there's a face, there's an ice cream cone, there's a lion, we've got watermelons, and then they go all the way up to being so complicated that you draw your own like Lego inspired characters. And it's been a project that's taken over my life for the last couple of years. And now I have a library of 56 of them, and I'll be adding some more this school year. Yeah. So there's plenty there, even if kids have done them before.
Yeah.
They're just so fun to make.
Yeah. And I recommend to the, to the teachers listening, I really recommend, even if you don't use them in your class, like if they, for whatever reason, don't fit what you teach, I recommend going in and trying one of those initial free ones that you offer, because the way you have set up the activity, I don't think I'd ever seen anybody do something like that in Google Drawings prior to that, or at least to that level where, you know, you use the white space as the space for the students to work in, and then you've got all your content off to the sides. And I guess the space isn't all white, but, you know, there's the workspace and then there's the content spaces out to the side. And it really is a neat kind of hyperdocs kind of layout that teachers can kind of mimic in slides or in drawings. Got the video in there and everything. Really, really cool. And I definitely recommend at least checking it out just to see kind of the setup of those things. Very cool stuff.
Yeah. You can find those at shapegrams.com.
Yeah.
The first four are free. So you could get, even if students only do the first four, they've learned a lot of great skills. When I taught fifth grade, that's when I started developing all these Shapegrams, and we did one a week. And by the middle of the year, they were great. By the end of the year, they could think of anything in their mind and then recreate it with shapes.
Kids from that first class turns 14, you could hire them all on to work for you and develop the Shapegrams now.
Exactly. And they started making their own, but you know, before they even had all the skills, they're like, oh, I want to make one. So they do it in their spare time.
Yeah. Yeah. I love that. How cool.
But enough about that. We are here to talk about you, Jake Miller. And I think we need to start with a game.
Of course. What else would you want? Educational Duct Tape, right?
All right, so this game is called, it's a Mad Lib, but I don't know, maybe that's copyrighted. So what would you call a Mad Lib?
Silly words.
Silly words, a preposterous story, perhaps. Anyway.
I like preposterous stories. I think that's a good one.
Yeah, or I got it. Preposterous paragraph.
There you go.
There we go. So this preposterous paragraph, I'm going to ask you to give me eight words that I want to get from you. And when I play Mad Libs with anybody, especially kids, I'm looking for those juicy words. So don't say run or jump for a verb. You know, I think of something more exciting, interesting, different, because then the story will turn out better.
Okay.
All right. So we're starting with a verb ending in ED.
Verb ending in ED. Cheated.
An adjective.
Tall. It's kind of a boring one.
That's all right, because you can do another adjective.
Okay, ready for another one? Preposterous.
Where'd you get that from?
Right.
Plural. I'm going to need two plural nouns.
Two plural nouns. Tater tots. And pennies.
One more adjective.
Shifty.
Ooh. And, let's see. I just got one more. A noun. Singular noun.
Dog. Now, if this was my kids playing, my words would have been stinky. Butt, fart, and who knows what else that would have worked in there.
Well, I think dog's kind of boring. I think this last noun could be butt.
Okay, we're going to go with butt. Okay, two T's or one T?
Well, if it's a noun, it's got to be the two. Okay. All right. So what I've done is I'm using the flippity.net template where you can make your own Mad Lib. So
yes.
I have copied a paragraph from your new book.
Uh-oh.
And I put it into Flippity and I've replaced keywords. And those are the ones that I just asked you for. So now I'm going to click show me the story. And here it is. This comes from your last chapter, actually, because I think it'll be a good conversation piece after we first figure out what this preposterous paragraph is.
Right.
So this is written in first person. So there's going to be I, but I means Jake, which is you, which is confusing. Okay. But anyway, as I cheated for writing this book, I spent some time writing down all the tall or preposterous stories I could recall. I knew some of these stories would be crafted into tater tots and become part of this book.
Mm.
After spending some time doing this on my own, I asked my pennies to try to think of shifty stories they remembered. All three of my pennies immediately thought of the same butt.
That was much better than dog.
And and I guess that is our little game here. Preposterous paragraph.
That was a preposterous paragraph, Tony. It was a good one. I love it. I love that you used flippity.net for it too. How cool. There's so much great stuff on there. And I geeked out about the Mad Libs one myself when I discovered that. And the funny thing, this goes back to a conversation we were having before we started recording. I once shared that on Twitter and somebody responded back to me and said, or you could use a pen and a piece of paper, dude. but this generates it and I can send it to kids. Come on.
Yeah. Oh, my fifth graders love these. And then they wanted to make their own too. And they would go home and do it with their parents. So I would often take paragraphs either that we had already read in our science, social studies, book, literature, wherever we've already read, and make that into a Mad Lib, or preview something that we haven't read yet, but we will in the future. So that when we come to that paragraph, they're like, oh, I remember what our preposterous version was, and they compare it to this one. So it's kind of fun. And it makes you start to wonder, well, maybe like the listeners are, what exactly was that paragraph really about? And I think it's what comes down to your book, educational duct tape book, is that you tell a lot of stories. And you've got a lot of great ones.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, and that really is how I came up with all those tater tots, stories, I literally had a list and my wall was covered with post-it notes as I thought about all of the different stories that I could potentially put in the book. And some of those post-it notes never gotten used and some of them did. And that particular one is about me asking my kids for some stories to include in the book. And they did generate at least one that ended up in the book, which is the one that comes up in that chapter. But yeah. That was it was the same tater tot from all three pennies came up with it.
Well, you came up. All right. Well,
or no, the same butt actually is what they all thought of.
They thought the same butt. They all three of your pennies. Awesome. Well, really, I got an advanced copy of the book, so I've actually read it a little while ago, and it's awesome. Everybody should get the book. I do have some questions that I want to know, or questions that I think the audience would want to know too. So
nice.
First, is this your first book you've written?
Well, unless you count, I've written a few books with my son, Beckett, who I mentioned earlier. We used to write books where he would tell us what to write down, and they were the adventures of two guys named Joe and John. They went to some monster truck rallies. They had Christmas. They ended up in space a couple times. And every story ended up with them taking a nap. So we always laugh at them. The story always ends with, then they had to take a nap. Like that was when he got tired of the activity. They took a nap. So unless that counts, mm-hmm. Yes, this is the first book that I've written. But it feels like it's been 10 books because I've been working on it for so long. So yes.
You know, I wrote a book, it was a little bit more technical oriented back when Palm Pilots and podcasting were new, and it was so much work. I said, I'm never writing a book again.
Yeah.
I'll read other people's books, but oh man, it was work.
And I'm sure at that point in time, it was even harder, you know, with the technology you were dealing with at that point in time to write it and things like that. It probably was a much more tedious experience even than what I've dealt with, I'm sure.
Yeah, we had to do step-by-step things because that's where the readers were at that time. Right. They needed to know exactly where to click and tap and do all that. But but I'm glad there are people like you reading books and putting your own spin on it too. But it is such a big task to write a book, and especially the way you wrote yours, because yours, you've got these great stories in there, but then also you have done your homework and you compare some popular EdTech tools. You had to really try these out, and then you give the results, telling the reader, you know, oh, well, use this one for this, or try this for here. That's a big job.
Right.
Why'd you go through all this trouble?
I don't know.
Wondering.
It feels like I did it to torture myself because mm-hmm. it was like, if you look at it and you think like, this must be a lot of work. Yeah. Yes, it was. And the reason I did it was there was two parts. So one part are those stories you're talking about. And I did those because I've seen the struggle and the stress that educators feel about educational technology. And I wanted to help them deal with that struggle and that stress. I know I wanted them to feel equipped and I wanted them to do it in a way that was fun. But then the other part is the part that you're alluding to where I'm giving the kind of like lists of different tools they could consider and the general kind of once overs of what those tools do. And the reason I did that, because I've seen those instances when as my time as a tech coach or as a presenter or through the podcast or, you know, maybe doing a virtual presentation or some coaching with somebody, somebody says, well, I want to do this in my classroom. What tool do I use for that? Or they maybe don't even ask. They just say, I don't know what to use for it. And I'm able to say, well, there's this tool and this tool and this tool. And they say, which one should I use? And I say, well, it depends. Like there's not a right answer, but this one does this and this and this, but it doesn't do that. And this one does this and this and this, but it doesn't do this or that. And this one does these things, but it doesn't do those things, right? And then they go, oh, thank you. Like you just saved me so much research. This is the one I want because I need that feature, whatever it might be. And then they run with it. And so I realized how much that was needed by educators and how much they appreciated it when I shared it for them. And so then I just kind of took it on as my duty to provide that for them. It was really hard to do because the tools keep evolving. Some of these tools are not very forthright about what they do provide until you really get in there and try it out. But I wanted to do that work for educators because I knew they needed it, right? I knew they needed that information and no educator is like, no, I've got an hour of spare time today. I'm going to go compare these three ed tech tools, right? They don't have that time to do that. So I was like, well, I'll do it for them. They could read that in two pages of my book, spend 15 minutes doing it and make the decision on which one to use and then go do it. So I really just wanted to provide that resource for them because I saw how needed it was for them.
Yeah, that's a key. I spend a lot of time with these tech tools and I still liked how you laid it out. And I'm like, oh yeah, oh, I didn't realize that this could do that. We're speaking in generalities, this and that, right. but it is true that it's incredibly, incredibly helpful.
Oh, thank you. I'm glad you feel that way.
Yeah. So tech books can become outdated really quickly.
Uh-oh.
And things are can be printed. If I think I found something when I had to write, I said, Jake, just so you know, I can't remember what it was now, but
it was Kidblog. You told me that Kidblog was now Fan School, and it had just been announced a week before or a couple weeks before, and I was like, oh my goodness, thanks, Tony. I'm in the middle of some edits right now. I can go change that right now. Yeah.
Oh, yeah, good. So you're able to change it.
Yeah. Yes. Yep. Yeah. So it's not outdated yet.
Yet that we know of.
Yeah.
So I'm curious to hear what is your approach in dealing with the fact that the content in a printed book can't be updated once somebody has it in their hands or on their shelf?
Right. And so that was when I was first planning the book out, I was not planning on doing like covering these educational technology tools in this way because I was scared of that. But what I ultimately decided is that the teachers wanted and needed some kind of resource to help them make these decisions. And I needed, it's actually a very educational duct tape thing. I thought these tools are going to go out of date, or like these, my information on these tools are going to go out of date and need updated very quickly. Yet the teachers want this information. So what tool can help me solve that problem? And really the solution was, well, a book can't be updated once it's out there, but the internet can. So I've built a kind of a back-end website for this book. I call it the Online Resource Hub. And anybody who has the book has access to that. And on that page, I'm doing kind of three things there. One is providing tutorials. So you go and you read about, you know, for example, in one chapter, you read about Pear Deck and Nearpod and Whiteboard.chat and Classflow. And you go, okay, this is the one I want to use. Now I've got to learn it, right? And so I'm providing those videos. Most of them are curated from other educators that I really respect, and I think they did a good job explaining it. Some of it's from me. But then the other part alongside those tutorials is here are the updates, right? Here are what these tools have added. And at this point, there's nothing yet that needs updated in that book. But, you know, you and I are talking on one of the last days of July, and we know that the first couple of weeks of August, there's going to be some updates. So as soon as that book goes to print, something's going to need change. And so that online resource that will be the place for me to provide that.
Yeah. Yeah. That is so handy. Yeah. And you embrace the fact that it's going to be outdated, like in chapter one,
right? Yes. you
talk about fashion trends and I took that not just as, you know, sometimes there's this flashy new tool that changes, but there's changes all the time. And we can't do much about it other than go with the flow.
So. Yeah. Yeah, we have to.
So when, let's see here. I got more questions. I'm new at this podcasting thing.
You're not. You've done this before.
I know we're on like this. I know we're on like episode what of this duct tape podcast, but
I think we're on 91. We're getting there.
I just don't feel like I've hosted 91 of these for some.
Yeah, it's surprising, isn't it? Like you just started. Like this is your first one you're hosting.
So we know that it took you a long time to write it, but actually, like, how long? Like, have you been working on this for several years? It's a culmination of a lot of your work, so it might be hard to put a number on.
Yeah, it's hard to truly say when it started, but the idea of educational duct tape, which is, you know, the namesake of the book, that's at least 6 years old, right? And sometime not too long after that, I started thinking, I think this could be a book. And the podcast was partially one of the goals of the podcast was to start this process, was to start finding the stories and gaining the information. I've learned a lot of the stuff about the tech tools that I put in there, I learned through the podcast. I had to really become an expert in some of these things to be able to talk about them on the podcast. But I think the Google Doc where I started writing this, that Google Doc is about 3 years old. Yeah, it started at least 3 years ago. But a lot of the pieces of it were in motion well before that. And I really thought there's been multiple times when I thought the book was going to come out. I thought this book would have been out at least a year and a half ago. And a lot, like, number one, it took longer than I thought it would. Number two, COVID really, I mean, it just crushed my productivity and it changed everybody's world. And so it was impossible for me to keep working at the same rate I was up to that point. And then just going through the revising and editing process and making the book better. That's been the nice thing is that even though it's taken longer than I foresaw it taking, every time I work on it, every time I respond to some feedback on it or whatever it might be, I feel the product getting better for the educators that it's going to. So even though I'm glad to be done, super glad to be done, I'm glad that the time's gone into it because I think it's improved because of it.
Did you consider a different name for the book or is it always
It's always been educational duct tape. Yeah. The only thing that was in consideration was what would the tagline be or what would the subtitle be or would there be a tagline or a subtitle? But yeah, it's been educational duct tape since day one. Although the first presentation that became educational duct tape was called something like choosing educational technology tools to solve the problems and meet the goals of your classroom or something really, really long and horrible like
just
that.
Just a few words. Yeah.
All right. Just a few words. And I asked, I one of the first times I did it, I presented it to it was a master's or undergrad EdTech class, I forget, through a professor that I'm friends with. And afterwards I said, I think I'm going to keep this presentation going. What do you think of it? And he said, I think it was really good, but you need a new name. He said that name was
the
not
name
very
takes
effective.
Up two slides.
So after that, it became educational duct tape and the book all along has been educational duct tape.
I know you mentioned about the hub piece, but you also really encourage readers to create this community and to interact. And so how's that exactly done?
So that'll be on that same space. And so I want it to be a space where they share their takeaways, maybe share what they've learned, maybe share, this is a little bit risky, but share what they think maybe I left out, which I've just got to swallow that pride and be ready for that.
That's a great question. Maybe a book is a little higher stakes, but that's my favorite question to ask at the end of a presentation. Right. What did I leave out that you thought would be here?
Right. They're going to tell me. They're teachers. Of course they're going to tell me, right? And that's fine because once we get used to doing that, we learn from that. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, you're going to have so many of your podcast listeners too, I think.
Yeah. And that's partially why I've done it. Yeah, that's partially why I'm doing that, because I've realized how powerful the two-way connection of a podcast is. Because a podcast, it feels like it's one way until you start connecting with the people who listen. And then you realize mm-hmm. just how two-way it is, that, you know, you meet them at conferences, or you talk to them on Twitter, or you get an email from them, or they send in an audio message, or they send in a Flipgrid. And that's where it gets really rich. One of my favorite parts of the podcast was when I used to do a chat around it on Twitter and get to connect with those people. And I don't have the time to manage that anymore. So I kind of retired that, or maybe put it on hiatus. But that's kind of inspired me. Like, I need a piece like that with the book too, because that's huge.
Yeah. Right. Something kind of interesting about the book is the chapter titles. They, instead of going exactly with like you'd expect from an ed tech book, the chapter titles have nothing to do with ed tech. Instead, they capture the essence of the stories that you're telling there. So let me just read for the listeners. You guys got to hear some of these chapters. So chapter one is a book about contemporary fashion trends.
It's a good one.
Chapter two, PJ pants, tater tots, and doctor's offices.
Yes.
Where there's chapter six, ramen noodles, lonely nights, and loud kids. chapter 11, panic teenagers, due dates and calendars. And chapter 12 is beards, glasses, and handsome teachers. So you got a total of 13 chapters going on each with these titles that are so great and just make me so curious or so intriguing.
Right.
And I know that the stories lead into something as an educator that I want to know. I want to know what wisdom you're sharing through these stories.
Those beards and glasses. What's that ramen noodle going to teach me?
Yeah. What is that ramen noodle going to teach me? They sound like Mad Libs, actually.
They kind of do. Yeah. It's like my kids named the book for me. They named the chapters of the book for me.
Yeah. All right. But I want to hear about your favorite chapter. Which one's your favorite?
So chapter three is titled Bounce Houses, Rolling Pins, and Duct Tape. And without that chapter, there's no book, right? Because that's when I first, years ago, really turned this metaphor into a story, right? And had I not done that, I think that changed my trajectory to being ready to be a podcaster, to being ready to speak at conferences. And up until that point, I was going to local conferences and I was doing like here's your Google Classroom 101, right? Or here's how to do Google Slides, right? And I hadn't taken that next step to maybe doing a keynote or speaking. And that story really was what kind of changed. Like, and I found my groove with it. And so that story means a lot to me. But the one that I think that I felt the best about when I write it was chapter 13, the last one, which is the one that we mad libbed earlier, or preposterous paragraphed, which is
titled, it's tissues, drips, and 8 years.
Yes, tissues, drips, and 8 years. And I, as I wrote that one, I felt like I talk a lot about the state of flow, where you start working on something and it just feels right and you get in the groove and you get in that state of flow and time kind of stands still. And it's like the art is making itself, or the music is making itself, or the writing is doing itself. I felt like that one just kind of poured out of me as I wrote it. And so I felt the best after writing that one. That's when the book felt like a book to me, was when I wrote that one. And I didn't know that'd be the last chapter until I wrote it. I wrote it and I was like, that's how the book ends. Like that feels like the ending of the book right there when I wrote it.
Yeah. And it's all great.
Yeah, thank you.
And then in the book, there are photos of you sporting different fashions, because the first chapter is a book about contemporary fashions. So we get to see pictures of you from 1986, 95, 2001, 2005, and 2014. And I have to say, listeners, Jake looks completely different in every single photo. I wouldn't know that was Jake Miller, except for it's like labeled there. Like you just completely reinvent your look every few years.
Some were better choices than others too.
Yeah. Well, your 2001 Mark McGrath inspired phase, that one's an eye opener. So I guess my question for that is, do you still have those hoop earrings that you were wearing in the picture?
No, I don't. I should have saved. Had I known how special those would be, I would have saved those earrings. I do still have the holes in my ears to provide evidence that that phase happened. But yeah, my earrings, the girl I was dating at that point in time convinced me that was a good idea and took me to Claire's in the mall. Ears pierced. Here I am, like, next to some, like, 12-year-old girls getting their first ear piercing. I'm like 19 or whatever at the time, getting my ears pierced. What was I doing, Tony? No, I do not have those earrings anymore. I should.
No, but they are memorialized in the book.
Right. Although someday I'll be cleaning something out and I'll probably find them in a box.
Well, you've weaved throughout the book your approach to solving problems, and yeah. it's really a highlight for me. Besides those highlights in your hair in the in that photo, but can you tease us, talk to us a little bit about your problem solving process?
Can you tell, by the way, I did those highlights myself? Is it clear?
No, I think the picture actually is in black and white, isn't it?
That's true. You're missing. Probably, I'll send you a color version.
I gotta see this in full color. Yeah. Yeah,
pretty rough. Yeah. So listeners of the podcast are pretty familiar with the process. It's kind of why I started recording the podcast was to help educators with this problem solving process and help them understand. I've seen too many educators both in my personal life, friends of mine, and in my day job, you know, as a teacher, the teachers I work with and teachers I have worked with, and in the stuff I do on the side, going and traveling and presenting or talking to people on Twitter, I see so many of them who are overwhelmed. There are just so many technologies. Mm-hmm. And I talk about Phyllis in the book, right? And it's a little ode to Phyllis from The Office and how Phyllis is just overwhelmed by all those educational technology tools. And so I really wanted educators to understand how I make the choice of what to use. So, you know, you said earlier that I used to be a tech coach. Now I'm a science teacher. So this will be year two back in the classroom for me as a science teacher. And last year I used, I don't know, I'm just spitballing here, maybe 6 different educational technology tools in my classroom. Yet in my book, I talk about 80, right? So how does that happen? How did I go from knowing about these 80 some and only using 6? And that problem solving process is how I decided on them, right? I thought about what is it that I'm trying to achieve? You know, last year was a really hard year for me in my classroom. And so I had to go like, what are my main goals, right? So I knew, you know, we started the year off remote. I really needed to build rapport with the kids. I really needed to make sure my kids were connecting. And I when they turned off their video camera on Zoom, I really needed to make sure they were still with me. And so Pear Deck became a huge tool for me. Or it could have been Nearpod, or it could have been ClassFlow, but Pear Deck was the one my school used. And so this is that process that brought me from going, okay, I need to connect with my students. I need to build rapport. I need to formatively assess them. I need to make sure they're participating and following along. What tool helps me with that? And try to find a tool that helps me with as many of them as possible. So in that situation, it was Pear Deck. And so I wanted to help educators. And that's why I speak about it. That's why I podcast about it. That's why I write about it, is to help educators be able to do that too. Because otherwise it's super overwhelming.
Yeah. Super. You know, I went back to the classroom after a dozen years doing consulting and mm-hmm. all this ed tech work, I kind of surprised myself by the end of the school year. I'm like, looking at all the tools I've been showing teachers over the years, I'm like, I barely used any of them. Yeah. Like, yeah. I could just teach with Google Slides and be pretty happy. Right. I didn't need all that other stuff.
Right. And that doesn't mean you did a bad job. It just means you used the tools that were best for you. And that's, I think that's also an important part to the message too, is that maybe another teacher, like I didn't use Google Slides very much last year because I had to design my Pear Decks, but you might have used them a lot. And it doesn't mean one of us did better than the other. It just means we use the tools that are best for our style or our curriculum or our whatever, you know? And so that's the mindset I'm trying to help people with.
Yeah. Well, speaking of tools in the book, you know, at some point you have to just say, this is it. I can't add anything more to it. Is there anything that you kind of wish you were able to include in the book, or anything new that just came out that you thought, that would have been great in this book.
So no new ones yet. I'm sure it's going to happen. Like that day is going to come where there's a tool that I should have included in there. There were a couple that just barely made the cut. Genially, for example, I started to see people I really respect starting to tweet mm-hmm. about it and share about it and post about it. And I was like, okay, I've got to go brush up on this and add this in the book. So that was something that got added in between edits 2 and 3 of the book. I added that in. And a tool like BlueKit, right? BlueKit just kind of mm-hmm. was after edit 1 of the book. I added BlueKit in once I started using it in my classroom. But there's none that haven't made it in yet. But what I did have to do was narrow it down, which I think was important too. You know, some of those sections where maybe I talk about formative assessment tools, I love tools like Slido and Spiral and Mentimeter and Plickers and Plickers. And like, there's so many tools that I love, and I'm like, at some point I've got to cut it off. Otherwise I'm going to overwhelm people. And I think that was the thing. I had to first overwhelm it to a manageable size set for them so that they could then choose from it. So that was the biggest thing, was taking tools out so that I didn't overwhelm everybody.
Yeah. I mean, if somebody wants all those tools, they can find a list on somebody's blog somewhere. But I think they're coming to your book, trusting your judgment and knowing the things you're going to show them are strong possibilities.
I could point them to a couple of educators who have those blogs that have all of the tools. Right. I'll send you to those. You'll probably feel overwhelmed, though.
Exactly. So tell us about your next book.
Oh gosh, it'll just be a story about Joe and John, Tony. No more. you know, it's funny, when I started laying out the chapters of this book, and I had all those post-it notes up on the wall that I mentioned earlier, there were, I think, 24 chapters in my mm-hmm. in my map, in my mind, and the book ended up with 13. I didn't realize how long 24 chapters would be. Right. Yeah. I didn't realize that was a ridiculous number of chapters. And so there are those 11 chapters on the cutting room floor that I guess technically could be part of another book. But I don't know if I can. So much work, Tony. It was so much work. If this one receives a positive reaction, people might have to beg me and petition me to write another one, because I don't know if I could bring myself to do it. As you said with yours years before, it's a lot of work.
Yeah. But duct tapers, you know what you have to do. If you like that book and you want another one, pester Jake and he'll do it. He'll do it.
I don't know.
Might take 3 years, but.
Right. 3 years. If I could have 3 years, maybe. No, I'm joking. I didn't say that. I'm going to cut that part out.
All right, Jake Miller, are you ready for another game?
Tony, I'm always up for games. Before we started this recording, I was playing Space Jam Monopoly with my kids, and I had to stop for this. And then we played a game of preposterous paragraphs. And now this is just the next game in my day. I'm ready.
Next one in your game. Okay. Well, this one is called More or Less.
I love this music. I feel like I could be that guy in that GIF going like that.
Oh, yeah? All right. So what I've done is I have done a word count on your book.
Oh, gosh.
I'm going to give you two terms, and you tell me which one is in there more than the other.
Okay.
Or I guess calling more or less, you can say more or less. Anyway, I'm going to give you two terms. We're going to figure out which one appears more times in the Educational Duct Tape book.
Okay.
All right. Let's see how you do.
Okay.
How about the first one is problem versus solve?
Oh. I'm going to guess that problem is stated more.
Problem is stated more is what you're saying. And yes. Correct.
One point. Is that worth 1 point?
Yeah. Yes. 1 point. Let me write down your score here.
Oh, thank you. Nice. Right. Tally mark. Yeah. Thanks for that.
There you go.
I feel like I should be like a student and offer to put it up on the chalkboard. Can I keep score on the chalkboard?
And the rest of the class yells at them when they get it wrong. No, right. We're supposed to go to the other.
You forgot to give us a point.
Yeah. All right, question two, let's compare technology versus teach.
Ooh,
And I will say too, because sometimes when you do this word count, if it has the word in it, so if teach would also be like teaching, teacher, and all of that.
Well, I know I don't say teacher very much because I wanted to write the book to the reader, right? So I say you and your a lot. So I'm guessing I don't say teacher a whole lot of times or teach that many. So I'm guessing technology is the most.
Technology. Jake Miller. That is not correct.
Oh, no. How many points do I lose?
Really close. They're really close. Okay. You know, you just don't get the point. We'll keep it positive. Okay. So you're still at one.
Do I get a redemption question? Is there a redemption question like in quizzes?
Well, I've got more questions.
Okay.
I'm sure you'll redeem yourself.
Okay.
They're actually really, really close to being equal, but teach appears just a few more times.
Okay.
How about video versus audio?
Ooh, video for sure. Now there is an audio segment and there's a video segment in the book where I go over some tools for each, but there's also a screencast segment. And there's one about formative assessment that mentions Flipgrid. So I'm going video more.
Yeah, yes. I'm writing a tally mark down. Video way more than audio, like 303 mentions versus 81.
Nice.
All right, let's do some tools then. Let's see which tools get more mentions. I think you can get this one. Flipgrid versus Kahoot.
I think everybody could predict this one. Flipgrid fares pretty well in the book because it could do so many different things, It's just such an amazing tool. So Flipgrid probably like 8-1 more than Kahoot, maybe more than that.
You are correct in that Flipgrid appears more, but only about a little over twice as much as Kahoot.
Wow. Okay.
All right. So we get another tally here. So 3 points. I've only got 8 of these questions.
Okay.
All right. Then how about some of the tools you don't mention all that often compared to like Flipgrid? We'll do Book Creator versus Scratch.
Ooh, I think they just each get one mention. I bet it's like 4-3. I'm going Book Creator.
Book Creator.
Ooh, no, you know what? But I do mention Scratch Junior. I wonder if that's separate. I'm going to stick with my answer, Book Creator.
Book Creator? Yeah. You should have changed that answer. Can't give you the point for that one.
That's so, your final answer.
The word Scratch appears about 15 times, Book Creator 5.
Yeah, man. Okay.
All right. Now our sixth question, flashcard versus Padlet. A flashcard, that's not a tech tool necessarily, but it is a tool.
I think flashcard more because we got to talk about how, you know, quizzes could do flashcards and Quizlet and some of the Kahoot can do flashcards. I'm going flashcards. And Flippity, as we talked about earlier, Flippity flashcards.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm going flashcard.
Flashcard appears more than Padlet.
Oh, no way.
It's kind of a trick answer because they're tied.
Oh, okay. You can't just give me the ding for that?
I'll give you the ding, too.
Thank you.
You get them both.
What I should get.
I don't know how to tally that. So
What if I would have answered they're tied?
I would have been like, are you looking at my screen right now? How did you know this?
I could have just opened up the book and done a word search, but you could have done that too. Yes. I'm an honest man though.
All right. Now question 7, the phrase duct tape versus screencastify.
Wow. How sad if screencastify appears more times in my book than actual duct tape, but I think there's a chance it does. I'm gonna go duct tape, but it's gonna be close.
It is close, but Screencastify is mentioned two more times than duct tape.
Oh, gosh. Oh, does hashtag EDU duct tape count? Or that's different? That doesn't count?
That would be different. That would be different.
Okay, that's weird.
I did it in quotes with the space in between.
That's a technicality right there.
It is.
I'm giving myself the point.
All right. And final question. Student versus tool.
Well, I hope it's student more. I hope so, because that's the goal, right? Is to pick a tool that benefits your students, right? So the students should come first in your mindset. And I think because I believe really strongly, and I this happens when I do presentations too, and I've attended sessions of yours. I remember years ago at the SciFair conference out in Texas, where you're very mindful of getting people to try out the student experience, right? With the tool they're using, right? What does it look like for a student? That's something I focus on a lot too. And so that's something I focus on a lot in the book, was what can the student do in this tool? So I think it's student. That's my guess.
Jake Miller, you are right. That is correct.
That would have been embarrassing if I was wrong.
Yes. It says student is about five times more than the word tool. Yes. Like the student is the word that appears more than any other word that I even tried looking for. So it's very student focused. That's what it's all about.
Yes, for sure. Yeah. The real test here would have been if you would have looked up my own three children's names and seen which child I mentioned the most. But don't tell them the results.
No, that would have been a can of worms. Yeah.
It sure is.
Well, Jake, it looks like according to my tally marks, you have four tally marks and a question mark. Thank you for playing More or Less.
Oh, Tony, I love it. That's so fun.
Well, Jake Miller, is there anything else you want to say about your book before we wrap up?
No, Tony, I want to say thank you to you. That's what I want to say to wrap up. I am so honored, number one, to have you on the Educational Duct Tape podcast twice, to have you as the first other person to host the Educational Duct Tape podcast, to have you as a person who wrote an endorsement for the book and will be literally your name will be printed in the book is giving me that endorsement. And it's also printed, I think, in the acknowledgments as the person who told me to change Kid Blog to Fan School. And it's just, I mean, Tony, the work that you're doing.
I pretty much wrote the book with you.
You pretty much did. You get 1% of
it. Just slap my name on that cover too, and we'll be good.
Add you on there. But seriously, Tony, having you affiliated with it and supporting it means a lot to me with the work that you've done. So not on the book. Not the work you've done on the book, but the work that you've done outside of the book, whether it's with Shapegrams or with your presentations or on your Palm Pilots or on your blog or wherever, Tony, it just means a lot to me. So thank you so much.
I enjoy being involved with it. I'm a fan of your work, and I do. I love podcasting. I started podcasting back in 2005.
Yeah.
And then about Palm Pilots, actually. And it was way too much work. So I really like just being a guest or a guest host even. Then I don't have to worry about RSS feeds and all that stuff.
I will tell you, Tony, I did not podcast in 2005, but I am willing to guess that part of it is a lot easier than it was then. The editing and stuff like that still takes a lot of time. But I think the duct tapers are going to be calling on you now to start back up that podcast. I think we're ready.
Yeah, or I'll just take over this podcast every once in a while.
Maybe. Tony, I'm a little under the weather. I need you to substitute host the podcast. Yeah, I would love that.
But, well, Jake Miller, thanks so much for being a guest on this episode. I hope everybody goes out to get the book once it's available, the Educational Duct Tape book. And I hope you'll come back as a guest sometime.
I have a feeling I will come back as a guest. Okay. Tony. Thank you so much for having me on the show. Oh, Tony, that's a blast.
Thank you for listening to the Educational Duct Tape Podcast. Please visit eduducttape.com to join the discussion, share possible topics, inquire about being a guest, or contact Jake. And remember, duct is spelled with a T, not a quack quack K.